coming to our learning objectives first. We will discuss the symptoms, the common symptoms of cardiovascular disorder. Next, I will discuss the features of cardiogenic breathlessness. Next, I will discuss the New York Heart Association grading of cardiological ailment. Next, I will give some brief discussion regarding the palpitation, then the cardiogenic chest pain. Now, the main theme of this year is the risk factors of the heart disease. We will discuss in detail, and next the common investigations to pinpoint the common cardiological ailment, and last the management. Now, coming to the symptoms of the cardiovascular disorder, this is a human body, and the human body has from head to toe, just define the symptoms of the upper part, that is the blackout. It is one of the common symptoms of the cardiological ailments. Next, the lower part, this is the thorax. Here the symptoms may be in the form of chest pain, it may be in the form of the shortness of breath, the palpitation, the cough with hemoptysis. And next, in the lower part of the trunk, that is the abdomen, there will be pain in the abdomen, maybe secondary due to hepatomegaly, due to congestive cardiac failure. And next, in the lower limb, there are symptoms may be in the form of pedal swelling and claudication, that is the intermittent pain while walking, and I will discuss. Now, coming to the features of cardiogenic breathlessness. Breathlessness in terms, it is defined as uncomfortable awareness of effort of wound breathing. That is, we are breathing normally and we are not aware about the fact that we are breathing, taking breath. But if someone becomes aware that he is taking breath or he or she is taking breath, then this is called breathlessness. So breathlessness of a person can be due to many much more factor, but in brief I will discuss the pinpoint the features of cardiogenic breathlessness, the breathlessness, the specific type pattern of the breathlessness, from which we can have a rough idea that the patient may have some underlying cardiological disorder. Now, the first point, it is precipitated by exertion and relieved by rest. The breathlessness is usually absent in normal activity. It is precipitated by exertion whenever the person or patient is having some activity, running or any physical activity, then it is the breathlessness, he is having this breathlessness, and it is relieved promptly by rest. Next, coming to the PND, paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, it is one of the important hallmark of cardiogenic breathlessness. The patient is usually at the time of going to bed, he or she is unaware regarding the his respiratory distress. Suddenly in the midnight he wakes up with the problems of respiratory distress, and once he or she wakes up, the gravitational support of the diaphragm helps to alleviate the symptoms. So it lasts for a few times only. It is the hallmark of cardiogenic breathlessness, the paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, the PND. Next, the fourth features of cardiogenic breathlessness, that is the severity, can be graded easily. The unlike the other cause of breathlessness, the bronchial asthma, the COPD, and the other causes, where the severity cannot be graded, but here we can finally to have a pinpoint and fine tuning of the grading of the breathlessness, that is the grading by New York Heart Association criteria. I will discuss in the next slide. Now, there is typically absence of wheeze. This is the hallmark of the airway tract obstruction. This wheeze and ronchi, these things usually are absent, and it is unrelated to seasonal variation. Where in the bronchial asthma, atopy, all these things having seasonal variation, but the cardiogenic breathlessness, that's the uncomfortable awareness of the effort of his own breathing, is unrelated to seasonal variation. These are in brief the features of breathlessness, and from these features we can have a rough assessment or idea that the patient is having the breathlessness due to underlying cardiological disorder. Next, coming to the New York Heart Association grading of cardiological ailments, there are four grading, grade 1, 2, 3 and 4. As we advances from grade 1 to grade 4, the severity is usually increases. Number 1, the grading, the mildest form of the cardiological, the respiratory distress, the breathlessness absent in normal activity and no limitation of the physical activity. That means the person is normal, is doing his day to day activity, and he is having no respiratory distress, and he has no limitation of the physical activity. Whenever he is having the excessive physical activity, the running, jumping, etc., then the breathlessness, respiratory distress happens. So basically it is a hidden type of problems. Number two, the grade two, the it is a however a one grade severe than the grade one. The breathlessness precipitated by normal activity. Normally he is walking and doing his outdoor activity. It is causing breathlessness. So if he is sitting idle, then there is no respiratory problem, and the slight limitation of the physical activity. Number three, and the breathlessness less than normal activity. Even he is sitting or sleeping, he is having respiratory distress, and obviously this lead to marked limitation of the physical activity. And the grade four, the severest form, breathlessness and respiratory distress present even at rest, and history of the paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea. The thing I have discussed just before is often present. Next, coming to the one of the important cardiological symptoms, that is the palpitation. I will discuss the in brief the etiological factors of palpitation, and the etiological factor can be grossly classified into physiological, that is in it is the palpitation can be seen in normal person, and the pathological and some psychiatric disorder. So like the breathlessness, palpitation, what is palpitation? So it is defined as uncomfortable awareness of the effort of his own heartbeat. Normally our heart is beating continuously without any interruption, and we are unaware about the heartbeat. So once the person becomes aware of his heart beating, then it is termed as palpitation. So like the common elements, the etiology can be defined as physiological and pathological. The physiological, the common without having underlying disease, the causes may be fight, flight, fear. So once the person is having fear or any having fight or any tussle with anyone or any severe exercise, that happens in normal person. So these are the physiological causes, and the pathological causes may be PSVT, paroxysmal supraventricular tachycardia. It is one of the important cardiological element. There is multiple the heart beats more rapid than the normal, and there is CHB, complete heart block. There is a terminate interruption of the impulse transmission of the impulse from the SNO to the down to the ventricle, and the systemic hypertension, it lead to cardiac overload, and subsequent the to work up to calm over the excessive overload, the heart beats at a rapid pace and the person becomes aware of his heartbeat. So the paroxysmal supraventricular tachycardia, the complete heart block, and the systemic hypertension, they are the common the pathological causes of palpitation. And some psychiatric cause, anxiety, neurosis, phobia, all these things may lead to palpitation in some cases. Now coming to the main the things, that is the which is our main concern, that is the chest pain. So we have chest, and the chest pain may be due to severe etiological, multiple etiological factors starting from outside to inwards. So outside means in the inside, outside our chest there is a skin, deep to the skin there is a subcutaneous tissue, there is a chest wall, chest rib, pleura, heart, esophagus, etc., mediastinum. So all these structures may lead to chest pain, but we need to pinpoint the typical features of cardiological chest pain. So skin condition may be due to herpes zoster infection or any subcutaneous abscess may lead to chest pain. Obviously these things can be demonstrated from externally, the herpetic vesicle around the nerve trunk, etc., and the pleural involvement, acute pleuritis or acute pneumothorax, tension pneumothorax. So all these things may lead to chest pain. Lung cause, the acute lobar pneumonia with overlying pleuritis, overlying pleura involvement, because pleura has only nerve supply, so it lead to chest pain. The mediastinal cause, the acute mediastinitis, the mediastinal inflammation, the esophageal rupture, the all these things may lead to chest pain. But the cardiological chest pain, the typical features is usually rectosternal, that is the central chest pain behind the sternum. It is crushing in nature, and typical radiation, the jaw, the left upper limb, the interscapular region, typical it has radiation. And the chest pain, cardiological chest pain is associated with profuse sweating, and is usually relieved by rest or nitrate. One exceptional is the unstable angina. I will come to discuss later. Next, the common causes of cardiological chest pain. There is a sub classification, the pathological condition that may lead to cardiological chest pain, that is the ischemic heart disease. Ischemic heart disease means a disease of the myocardium when there is an imbalance between demand and supply of oxygen to some part of the myocardium, that is the ischemia. The heart requires more, but the supply of oxygen is less. So it may lead to ischemic heart disease, chest pain. Acute myocardial infarction, this is the necrosis of a some part of the myocardium due to sudden occlusion of the terminal artery, most commonly the anterior descending branch of the left coronary artery, may lead to cardiological chest pain. Next, pulmonary thromboembolism, it usually found in patients having hip surgery or any paraplegia patient who is having prolonged bedridden patient. So the as the patient is prolonged bedridden, the blood circulation becomes sluggish. All the factors of Virchow's triad beats activated and subsequently lead to venous thrombosis and subsequent thromboembolism. That is, the blood coagulates in the leg vessels and subsequently reaches to the pulmonary vasculature and occludes the parts of the pulmonary blood supply and lead to pulmonary thromboembolism. So it may also lead to chest pain. The acute pericarditis also may lead to chest pain. And the dissecting aneurysm of aorta, it may also lead to chest pain. The dissecting aneurysm of aorta, what it means, it is commonly seen in connective tissue disorders, the Marfan syndrome, the Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. So what happens in this disorder, the connecting tissue becomes very weak. So the blood collects between the tunica intima and the media, and there is a dilatation of the descending thoracic aorta. So the distal pulse crest is one of the important clinical hallmarks in dissecting aneurysm of aorta, and the pain is usually the parasternal in nature. Acute pericarditis, viral, maybe tubercular, it usually the pain is stitching or stabbing in nature, and usually it leads to heaviness and relief on stooping forward and precipitated or aggravated by supine. Why? Just behind the heart there is the esophagus, and if the pericardial inflammation strikes against this structure, it may aggravate the pain. It usually lasts for few days and relieves with a sense of heaviness. The pulmonary thromboembolism, as I have discussed, the etiological factor, the mechanism, and the typical clinical features of pulmonary thromboembolism: sudden onset chest pain, the petechy, there is a hemorrhagic spot involved overlying the chest and associated with cough with hemoptysis, the blood coughing out of blood. These are usually seen in pulmonary thromboembolism. The acute myocardial infarction, the central gastrosternal chest pain with profuse sweating, typical radiation and relieved by rest on nitrate, and ischemic heart disease I have discussed. Now coming to the theme of our this year, that is the risk factors of cardiologic disorder, the ischemic heart disease and all this acute coronary syndrome, all this spectrum. So the risk factors can be classified into non-modifiable and modifiable. This is modifiable. So non-modifiable risk factors, that these things cannot be modified. The risk factors is a background risk factor that is common to all. Number one is the age. As age increases beyond the 45 to 50, the incidence of ischemic heart disease and the coronary artery disease increases. Sex, in female of childbearing age, this is usually remarkable protected from the coronary artery disease. However, beyond the menopause, the risk is usually equals between men and the female. And race, it has been seen in Eskimo, they have usually less chance of development of the ischemic heart disease and coronary artery disease compared to the Southeast Asian. They are more vulnerable to develop all this cardiological ailment, mainly the ischemic heart disease. And the family is to definitely plays an important role, and which are all non-modifiable, we cannot have any control over these risk factors. Now coming to the concern, that is the modifiable. So these things, if we becomes aware previously, then this subsequent development of this fatal myocardial infarction can be avoided. Number one is habit related modifiable. The sedentary lifestyle, it is one of the major risk factor of cardiological disorder. So once even the person is lean and thin and he is spending majority of the time sitting idle and doing nothing, so sedentary lifestyle is one of the important risk factors. Now coming to the smoking. Smoking is one of the important major risk factor. The alcohol, obviously alcohol, there is a controversy. The recent guidelines told that small amount of beer intake may provide protection. Next, coming to the diet, definitely diet rich in fresh fruit and vegetables are protected against the coronary artery disease. And the polyunsaturated fatty acid, the sunflower oil, safflower oil, all these things are helps in protection for development of the cardiological ailments. But some diets we should avoid. Number one is the red meat, and number two, that is the plant source, that is the coconut. These are the major culprit of early development of the coronary artery disease. And small fresh fish also is beneficial, and it helps to prevent the development of the disease. Now coming to the modifiable metabolic risk factors. Number one, obesity. As we all know, the obesity is defined as the body mass index, the universal criteria. It is calculated by weight in kg divided by height in meter square. The normal range is 18.5 to 24.99. The normal around 23. If it is beyond 25 to 29.99, it is overweight, and beyond 30 to 39.99, it is pre-obese, and beyond 40, it is obese. And obesity highly increases the risk of the coronary artery disease, early onset coronary artery disease, and the diabetes. Obviously, the diabetic angiopathy and altered lipid profile, the dyslipidemia, mainly the increased LDL level, that is the bad cholesterol, and decrease in the HDL level, that is the good cholesterol, all may lead to development of the early onset coronary disease. Chronic renal failure, the hyperhomocysteinemia and hypothyroidism, they are some modifiable metabolic risk factors. Now coming to the investigation of a common, most common and clinically important, the acute cardiological ailment, the AMI. There are some routine investigation. These things are needed to find out the exact etiology and subsequent planning of the management. Now, the routine investigation, hemoglobin is important, because if the patient is low hemoglobin, definitely anemia is one of the important cause of chest pain, exertional breathlessness, chest pain, palpitation. So, low hemoglobin, the patient is having chest pain might be due to low hemoglobin without any underlying cardiological disorder. Now, coming to the glucose, to find out the pre-existing diabetic glycemic state, as well as the diabetic patient has a very important condition, that is the silent AMI. The patient is having massive cardiac attack. The ECG finding, the blood investigation is corroborative. However, the patient is without having any symptoms. Now coming to the renal function test, the homocysteinemia, the chest X-ray. So all these things may help in find out the exact cause. Now coming to the special investigation, the ECG electrocardiogram. Here is the ST segment. The ST elevation is one of the important hallmark of acute myocardial infarction. And the stress ECG, sometimes in the ECG, the chest lead is usually V1 to V6, is usually lying in front of the chest. So by it is unable to pick up the silent, the cardiological ailment, mainly the posterior wall AMI or infection. So sometimes the stress ECG or even 12 lead chest ECG is also helpful. The echo Doppler, the 2D echo that find out the regional wall motion abnormality, may be suggestive of these ailments. The PET scan, and the gold standard is the invasive coronary angiography. Here we can easily find out the exact site of the problem, and subsequent it is diagnostic as well as therapeutic. So if the percutaneous coronary angiography can be done within 3 hours of onset, it may be life saving. Now coming to the management, towards the end of my slide, the acute and there are some general management and specific management. General management, obviously hospitalization is needed, because the acute, the patient might expire in any time. The ICU support, the bed rest and continuous monitoring of the vitals is necessary. The common emergency management is the sublingual lisinal titrate or nitroglycerin tablet 0.5 mg. If it is a very nice drug to alleviate the symptoms as well as the life saving. It is usually given under the tongue, the sublingual, and may be repeated at 5 minutes interval. The maximum 4 tablet can be given in one setup. Number 2, the drug is Ecosprin. Common Ecosprin, the 150 mg, but here for this management usually the 300 mg is prescribed. Some amount of this tablet is asked to chew and rest to be swallowed. Next, coming to the moist oxygen inhalation via face masks, liquid diet for 12 hours, and active passive range of motion of limbs. These are the general management. Coming to the specific management, to ingestion morphine sulfate, it is 4 mg IV. It can be repeated to alleviate the pain, and maximum 4 doses can be given at 5 minutes interval in one setup. Next, coming to the thrombolytic agent, what it does, there is a multiple thrombolytic, fibrinolytic, the streptokinase. It dissolves the clot formation inside the myocardial blood vessel, and if it is suitable, if it is done within 3 hours of onset of this chest pain, it is a very nice drug. It is usually commonly prescribed in 1.5 million unit in 100 ml normal saline and infused intravenous for 1 hour. Now with the beta blocker, the metoprolol is also a very nice drug. It decreases the myocardial workload and the decreased oxygen requirement. The lisinopril AC inhibitor, the atorvastatin, these are the common specific management, but the gold standard is the percutaneous coronary intervention. If the facility is available and the patient comes within 3 hours of onset, then the invasive coronary angio and angioplasty can be done. Next, the tablet clopidogrel, the heparin, the enoxaparin, and the warfarin, that is the acetrom, to keep 5 milligram per tablet, usually 5 days in a week, and to keep the international normalized ratio within 2 to 3. These things is commonly prescribed. So the take home message is the today we have discussed regarding the symptoms of the cardiological disorder, from head to toe, the blackout, the chest pain, the exertional breathlessness, palpitation, pain in the upper abdomen, pedal swelling, and the claudication, the pain in the leg. All these symptoms may help to find out whether the patient is having problem of underlying cardiological disorder. The cardinal features of chest pain, the cardiological chest pain, as I have discussed, that is retrosternal crushing, typical radiation jaw, left upper limb, interscapular region, associated with profuse sweating, relieved by rest and nitrate. Risk factors, definitely there are some modifiable as well as non-modifiable risk factors I have discussed. Non-modifiable, that is the age, sex, race, these are the non-modifiable, and the modifiable, there are some metabolic factor and some diet related factor and some lifestyle, the sedentary lifestyle, and all these things may lead to development, and prior identification of this risk factor helps in prevention, and the emergency management I have discussed. Thank you for your patience here. Now our respected sir, Dr. Shubhu Sir, CMS sir, brief some lecture.